huge effect of this so-called cultural politics. You know, today politics is becoming more and more cultural. We claim in our post-political era, economy and so on, this is for the experts. The only thing we are allowed to debate is, you know, abortion, yes or no, gay marriages, yes or no. Those in power like these debates because, you know, it doesn't disturb their market movements, whatever. So what I'm saying is that it's so important today to keep open this more radical public use of reason, especially because, you know, we may be very marginal, we are, but there are so many obstacles to what we are doing on all sides. For example, let me tell you a madness. Just before I came here, I got a plea from a friend, a Slovene, who lives here, and who told me, I heard that when you will be here, that out of solidarity with Palestinians, you will refuse to talk to any Jews. And then, like, please, they are not all bad. I mean, you know, I don't like to be addressed like that, because it provokes my worst sarcastic, tasteless instincts. You know, somebody tells me Jews are not bad, no? I'm tempted to say, yes, they are bad, but I'm even worse than them, or something like that. No, but seriously, you know, so many people try to poison all this. So my defense is not, no, I have to talk to Jews, some of them are my best friends, because you know what this phrase means, no? So I'm, again, in my tasteless way, I'm supposed to say, he wasn't radical and violent enough. Now, of course, he should have killed all of us Jews or what? No, you know what I meant. And I will now, for a short beginning, try to convince you that I was right. Something started to worry me very much in my own country and in other neighboring countries. These are, and this will be my great thesis, I know now it's a fashion to say new anti-Semitism of the left. Well, I'm sorry to inform you. The good old, ironically good old, of course, anti-Semitism is well kicking, thriving, and getting stronger and stronger in Europe now. We have enough to worry there. Namely, what happened, and for me, these are horrible signs, you know, these small things happening here, there, nobody even notices them. Okay, so what happened is this. All of a sudden, in Slovenia, Croatia, and some other Central European countries, it was like a contagious disease. It became fashionable among sportsmen, especially the winter sportsmen, ski and so on, to make a reference to Hitler to Wehrmacht, like when they were asked, are you ready for tomorrow's slalom? The standard answer became ready like the German army on the 22nd of June or whatever. And then, of course, when people exploded, they said, no, no, of course, Hitler was a criminal, but we only meant purely militarily. They were courageous, they were ready, and so on. And my idea is that here I, not always, but here agree with Hannah Arendt, that this kind of a romantic demonization, okay, not so much romantic, of Hitler and the Nazis, you know, in the sense, they were criminals, but they had balls, as they put it, you know. They were these demoniac, heroic criminals. You give them too much. I think, no, Hitler was not misdirected, but courageous guy, ready to fight to the end. In a fundamental social sense, Hitler was a coward. Hitler was afraid. Here I'm an old-fashioned Marxist, I'm sorry. Hitler did all the things he did, not in order to really change something, but so that fundamentally in the socio-economic order, nothing would have changed. He was ready to kill people, whatever, precisely to maintain the system. Or in Nietzschean terms, to which I refer here, although I'm not a big fan of Nietzsche, although he has a wonderful thought, you know, his Nietzsche's idea in, I think, Genealogy of Morals, that it's a crazy idea, that the best thing would have been for Jews and Germans to fuse together, because then you would have the German military discipline, the Jewish talent, industry, and together, you know, nobody could be. Okay, but seriously, this is crucial, I think, to get it that we shouldn't, you get my point, we shouldn't even give to Hitler this. that he was a great courageous figure, although criminally misdirected. No, he killed millions because he was afraid to act, to be violent when it clearly matters. He was afraid to do what? To do what even Gandhi did, which is fine. Nobody quoted that. I went on in the same phrase claiming Hitler was not violent enough in the sense in which Gandhi was more violent than Hitler. By violence, of course, I don't mean physical killing. I mean Gandhi did try to do something in India, which is simply to stop functioning the British colonial state, which Hitler never dared to do. His entire violence, and Hannah Arendt, Adorno and others got this very well, that all this Nazi spectacle, today Kristallnacht, tomorrow a big gathering in Munich, whatever, were vain, empty pseudo-events destined to cover up the fact that nothing is really happening. You know, Hannah Arendt, okay, millions died, but not to achieve something, but precisely to prevent something from happening. You know who had some very nice papers on this? Hannah Arendt, when he writes, don't be seduced by Hitler, this Hitler's heroic anti-petit bourgeois rhetoric. Hitler was a true slave of the petit bourgeois. So, there are many other points along these lines where I may appear sometimes problematic, but I think I'm doing the right thing. Because I think in today's situation, we are so deep in ideology, everyday ideology, that you have to do a provocation to arouse the people, and then, of course, you have to make the point. So, again, let me now finally at least begin half past properly. I would like to begin with a wonderful quote. I'm sorry if it is known to some of you, which I really like. It's a quote from my favorite Catholic theologist, Gilbert Keith Chesterton. Don't be confused. I'm a total atheist, and I'm definitely not pro-Catholic. I incidentally support a movement now in England, started by two of these aggressive atheists. I don't like their atheism, but nonetheless, Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens. The idea is to try, like Pinochet, to arrest the Pope when he will visit England as a chief of a big illegal pedophilia organization. I totally support it. You know, because this is what is needed, for example, in Hague. No? It's easy to arrest these poor third world dictators. You know, let's bring some of this. Okay. Here is what Chesterton says. In his book, I think it's in his novel, The Man Who Was First Dead, he has a wonderful idea, which is crazy. He proposes to organize, quote, a special corps of policemen, policemen who are also philosophers. And now there is the quote. The work of the philosophical policeman is at once bolder and more subtle than that of the ordinary detective. The ordinary detective goes to tea houses to arrest thieves. We go to artistic tea parties to detect pessimists. The ordinary detective discovers from a diary or a note in a book that a crime has been committed. We discover from a book of sonnets that a crime will be committed. We have to trace the origin of those dreadful thoughts that drive men on at last to intellectual fanaticism and intellectual crime. So it sounds a crazy idea. The true cause of trouble are not small revolutionaries, whatever, but philosophers who implant the wrong ideas, so let's do police work there. Now, this may sound strange, but would thinkers as different as Karl Popper, Theodor Adorno, or Emmanuel Levinas, would they not, I claim, subscribe to a slightly changed version of this idea, where the actual crime is called totalitarianism and the philosophical crime is called totality? Now, this idea that the philosophical notion of totality as, oh, we want to grasp it all, is the first step on the road which leads to political totalitarianism. or, as some leftists like to say in the West, in a rhyme, from Plato to NATO, you know, that straight line. So the idea is that the task of philosophical police is to, and some of Karl Popper definitely reads like this, to discover from a book of Plato's dialogues or a treatise on social contract by Rousseau that a political crime will be committed. The ordinary political policeman goes to secret organizations to arrest revolutionaries or terrorists. The philosophical policeman goes to philosophical symposia to detect those who propose the notion of totality. No? I claim that we should plead guilty, we philosophers. We are really doing it, and we should continue doing this dangerous work. But I claim not in the way Chesterton claims. What we are doing will generate an unfreedom of its own. That's the true task of a philosopher, I claim. To not to remain at the bad thing, the crime, whatever, as a distortion of a notion, but to show how this notion is already in itself distorted. For example, let me take capitalism. Today, I hope you have noticed, I'm allergic, that's why this, but not in the sense you think. I went to a doctor and asked him why, to what am I allergic. He did those stupid measures and claimed you're allergic to everything. I'm lucky that I'm not too allergic because I like this. Yes. Okay. What I wanted to say is that capitalism, it's way too easy today to be anti-capitalist. Our media even have what some friends of mine call an overload of anti-capitalism. You know, you open newspaper, what do you read? This company is using slave child labor, that company is polluting environment, that bank is cheating. But it's all at this level of a simple misuse, distortion of a notion. It's potentially, even I'm tempted to say, anti-Semitic. In the sense that you don't locate the failure into the system itself, but it's always this idea, the system can be saved, but there are some corrupted people, we have to eliminate them, no? Which is why, and I'm not flattering you, I almost was tempted a year ago when it happened to write a plea to celebrate, to redeem Bernard Madoff. No, I'm not crazy. But I found it suspicious how everything focused on him, you know, that sleazy guy and so on. But wait a minute. Okay, he's not my ethical idea, I admit. But the problem is not him. The problem is what kind of a system enabled him to do it and even pushed him to do it in a way. Because he was, for me, the ideal capitalist today extrapolated to the extreme. You work in an extremely risky way, get indebted in this gray borderline between cheating and not cheating, and then to redeem yourself, you give half of it back to charity. I like this idea. You steal 20 billion, you give 10 billion back, and you are the greatest humanitarian on earth, but you keep your 10 billion, you know. So what I'm saying is that, or even another provocative text I wanted to write, but in this, celebrating British Petroleum in the South, you know, in Louisiana oil spill, no? There, also, I'm not crazy, they should be punished, but are you aware that, and I talked about this with journalists who looked into it, that most of the, practically all the oil drilling companies use basically the same apparatus, so it was more or less, okay, they were maybe a little bit worse than others, but it was more or less contingent that it happened with to them. It could have happened to other companies as well. So, my God, we should not raise the problem at this level of either personal guilt, like this, that when things go wrong with capitalism, you find the corrupted guys. You should know this, because you know, your race will be sooner or later there. Or the opposite, to focus on the good guys, charity and so on. And this is also important, because today's capitalism, I claim, more and more includes charity is no longer eccentricity, like, oh, he's a little bit of crazy, he gives too much to charity. It's a claims part of the normal functioning, for economic reasons even, of capitalism. Let me give you a simple example about which I've already written in some of my books. Do you have the misfortune here of having on your streets already, I didn't find them, I hope this was a good sign, Starbucks coffee? You do have.
They closed them.
Sorry?
They failed.
With all the things you are doing, there must be something good in you. Serious. You know why? Because they are the worst ideology embodied. You know what is their trick? I don't know if they work like this here, but in the United States, in England, in Germany, they work like that. When you enter a Starbucks coffee place, you usually have a poster where they tell you, yes, our coffee is cheaper than that, more expensive than that of competitors, but then comes the bullshit, you know. We give 1% to starving children or in Guatemala. We give 1% to save the forest there. That is to say, in the good old normal, I almost admire it, exploitative consumerist capitalism, you consumed and then you felt bad, and then you had to do something opposite, you know. But what Starbucks is telling you, you, with us, you can be a pure consumerist, you don't have to worry, because your ethical duty to fight consumerism is already included in price, you know. It's the structure of what once I called chocolate laxative, which they have in California, you know. You add laxative to chocolate, which is supposed to give constipation, so you eat more chocolate, and this is, I think, a nice example of how ideology works today. Also, what is important is to move to real solidarity from all these charitable practices. Because, you know, let's take even a very traumatic topic, because I think we are really all, to be vulgar, in deep shit about this, ecology. You notice how, instead of confronting the real questions, how to reorganize economy and so on, we much prefer to play this comfortable game of so-called lifestyle ecology. You know, I'm careful, every newspaper, I recycle it, every plastic bottle and so on. Okay, it's good, I'm doing it. But let's be frank, this is more ideology than reality. In what sense? Let's be frank. Why are we doing this? I claim it's more in order to feel well. You know, in the sense of, isn't it beautiful? It gives you a good feeling that, isn't it beautiful? Every day I do something for Mother Nature. I am repaying the debt of humanity to Mother Nature. I'm part of a big movement. I care, and so on. It's a wonderful example of everyday ideology. What I'm afraid is that a little bit like, you know, that wonderful paradox of this everyday superstition. If you are a football, soccer fan, but are too lazy, as I of course am, to go to the stadium, you stay at home, but when your club is fighting, you act at home, you know, like, oh, shouting, as if in a kind of a magic thinking, this will really influence the game there. Well, I think that doing all this recycling, I'm not saying it's bad, but it's a little bit like shouting in front of a TV at home. Or even, let me provoke you more, look at those organic apples, so-called. Do you really believe that those half-rotten apples, which cost twice the price of normal, biologically, genetically modified apples that we all like, do you really think, maybe they are, but I don't think that we even really believe it. It's more ideology, you know. I'm doing something, solidarity, it makes me feel well. We are literally the surplus that we pay. We don't really pay it for real effects. We pay it in order to feel well. This is, I think, again, how it effectively works. And this is part of the logic that I like to describe with this wonderful, maybe some of you know it, again, I'm sorry if I repeat myself, paradox. It's a wonderful anecdote, again, maybe you know it, I'm sorry. You know, in the middle of the First World War, there was a proverbial, probably it didn't really happen, but as Italians say, se non è vero, è ben trovato. It's a wonderful invention. In the First World War, I think 1916, that's the legend. The German headquarter sent to the Austrian headquarter a telegram saying, with us, the situation on the front is serious but not catastrophic. Okay, you can imagine what the Austrians answered, no? With us, it's catastrophic but not serious. But isn't this how we are reacting, for example, to ecology? We admit it's catastrophic, but we cannot really take it seriously. You know, we think we will go out through these games of recycling or whatever. So, okay, let me make now the next step. This is one, maybe the only one, but I want to make it philosophical point. I want now even to defend the notion of totality as a good Hegelian. You know, if you really closely read Hegel, his notion of totality is not what people think, like everything appears dispersed, inconsistent, but then the philosopher is the magician who somehow convinces you that that all that appears to us as confusion is part of a higher harmony. No, here I am, I say this shamelessly. I consider myself part of the religions of the book legacy, Jewish, Christian, Muslim. For me, the greatest, not the greatest, okay, who is the greatest one, but the first real critique of ideology is, how do you pronounce it, the name, the guy who was screwed up by the book of Job. Job, did it? Yeah. Why? Are you aware what pearl you have there? Because you know what happens there, you know. But what really happens? Okay, things go bad for Job. Then we get what? Then we get the three ideologists, no? Are they three or four? I think three. Each of them comes with a precise message to Job. The point is he guilty or not? The message is your suffering has some deeper meaning. No? The first one says something like, I simplified, I know. The first one says something like, God is just, so if you suffer, even if you don't know what, look deeper into yourself, you must have done something wrong. The second one says something like, God is testing you and you will be rewarded. There is meaning in it. The beautiful thing is that, you must know this, my God, when God appears towards the end, he says, everything that these three ideologies, God is the agent of critique of ideology, no? He says, everything that these three guys said was wrong, all the complaints, everything that Job said is true. Now comes a theological point, I hope you will like it, the crucial ones. Then, nonetheless, Job asks God, but listen, but nonetheless, my life is screwed up, I suffer. Why? Now comes the point how to read this. Because the usual reading, I don't know how you guys do it, but in my Christian circles, no, is to emphasize the radical gap that separates God from humanity. Like, you know, who are you even to question this? What do you know? Who are you? You can't know, like this kind of above arrogance. But again, Chester has a wonderful thing in his short text available online on the book of God. He said when God says, you know, something like he enumerates God all the monsters, but when I created this monster, that monster, where were you? He reads this more as a kind of a history, blasphemy, that God becomes blasphemous for a moment and admits his impotence, basically, to cut a long story short. The message of God to Job is, you think you are in deep shit, but look, the whole universe is a big mess. You know, like that God, in a way, abdicates. And this, I think, is the greatest part of the, for me, let's call it not only for Judeo-Christian legacy, that God is no longer this kind of, it returns in Catholicism, which is why Catholicism has some problems. You know, God is this kind of a good guy up there, and things here may be in deep shit, but you can remain calm. There is an old guy up there pulling the strings. Everything will turn out okay, and so on and so on. No? I think that if you bring the Judeo-Christian logic to the end, this God has to be off. The first step here is, this is how I read it. The first step it made is made by you. You know, my friend Udi told me those wonderful story, but there are, I think, my friend Noam told me another. You know, there are two, I think, in your Talmud, wonderful stories where there is a conflict among your guys, rabbis, and then one of them calls God, no? And God gives the right to this one, but then the other guys said to God, basically, fuck off, you wrote your law, now you're a stupid old man, go on. And God says in both versions, oh my God, my sons defeated me and runs away. You know, that's a good step, I claim, and I shouldn't take it as a joke, no? And this is also how I read the Christian gesture of the death of Christ. It's not that a messenger dies of God. No, no, as Hegel put it, God himself of beyond dies. What is over at this level? Is this, for me, the most disgusting formula of religious justification, legitimization, this argument of harmony of a painting. You know this allegedly deep mystical insight that what we perceive as evil is the same as when you watch a painting, but you are too close to a painting, you see just a stain. But if you adopt proper distance, you see how what appeared to you as a stain is part of global harmony. But I have some problems here. Let me take the usual bad guys, like Holocaust, Gulag, and there are others, what happens today in Congo, and so on. Well, I'm somehow not ready to say that the Holocaust, Gulag, Congo only appear to us as horrors, but if you adopt the proper perspective, you will see that this contributes to global harmony, so ever, no? I think the real greatness of these traditions, religions of the book, is that on the contrary, they reject this global view. They assert, even if it doesn't look like this, the absolute right of particularity. No, when you are really in deep shit of suffering or whatever, you cannot make this step into this wisdom from which all the vain human struggles are just elements of a global harmony or whatever, and so on and so on. So I think, again, it's crucial to bear this in mind when we talk about theology today, which is the reason I am, again, my God, people proclaim me to be Western Orientalist for this. I am for the Western religious legacy. You know why? For example, now I will try to provoke you. There is a feature that you, if not all of you are, I know, that if you are not only Jews, but yeah, Jews, that you share with Muslim a very deep insight, which is this, how should I put it, externalization of goodness. Goodness, even divine contact, is not something deep in you. It's not this bullshit of inner journey, you discover what you are deep in yourself. It's like X-Files, you know.
Closer,
okay, sorry. It's like X-Files, you know, the truth is out there. This is how I read your iconoclasm, which is not, oh God is so transcendent, no painting, but as Levinas said, and generally I don't agree with him, as Levinas wrote, no, iconoclasm means God is only present in how you socially interact with other people. That's why no images of God. Not because, you know, it's so mystical or whatever. And the same thing, nonetheless, you find it in Quran, where they, you know, this is a nice point there, where you read that the inner conviction, belief, that's your private decision. All is wanted is that you obey publicly the rules and so on and so on. I like this accent of externalization of it. I'm always suspicious of this idea, even Zen Buddhist, I'm not too big fan of Zen Buddhism, that the only way to fully realize yourself is to withdraw into the inner authenticity of yourself, which is beyond good and evil. Well, and then you end up, let me mention two checks. Daisuke Spetaro Suzuki, if you are old enough, you may remember him from the 60s. Zen popularizer and Heinrich Himmler. You know, it was the sacred book of Heinrich Himmler. By sacred book, I mean the book he literally carried in his pocket, a special edition all the time, Bhagavad Gita. What is he like there? You know that central scene where Arjuna confronts the enemy army and has doubts, like, my God, thousands will die, blah, blah. And you know what Krishna tells him? Oh, the self is eternal, reality is just a mixture of phenomena, so what's the problem? Kill them all. I simplified, but that's the point. Suzuki says the same. You know that Suzuki was in the 30s a great popularizer of Japanese military intervention in China. And you know what he wrote? There you have Zen Buddhism. He wrote a good advice on how Zen Buddhism can help soldiers to do the killing. The idea is this one. Let's say, don't take it personally, but somebody has to be doing it. Okay. You as a Jew must be used to it. So let me take you. Let's say we are in a struggle and I have a knife and commander orders me whatever, I have to pick out your eye and whatever. I must admit it that, like, I'm not saying I'm a very good person, but I would have some problems with it, no, to put it mildly. You know what is here? Suzuki's advice, literally. If that the problem is in my wrong perception, because I'm still victim of this false reality, where I still believe in the substantial unity of my ego, so I perceive myself as an agent who is acting, moving hand, and moving my hand with knife and sticking the knife into you. But it says, once you reach the Buddhist enlightenment, Satori, your perspective totally changes. You perceive yourself as nobody, a void, a totally impassive observer on your of your own acts. And the situation here is that you do not raise your hand. You see your hand dancing in this cosmic dance of phenomena, and as part of the same dance, your eye somehow, don't ask me how, falls on it, and so on. No, this is not a joke. These guys were really, no, I'm not saying that they are any worse than us. What I'm saying is something much more tragic. You know that another good guy, ironically, my God, I hope I will not be again attacked, Reinhard Heydrich. You know what really shocked me about him? I read in a history of whatever it says, Gestapo, that he, in the evenings, met with friends, built a string quartet, and was playing very well with them, late Beethoven's string quartets. Now, my God, we are talking about one of the top hits, I have to put it in a cheap way, of music, no? And here I'm a pessimist. I claim it's somebody saying no, he was playing with a ghost. No, what I'm saying is that, you know, the true tragedy is that it's maybe too easy to say, yeah, but it was a fake, he didn't really understand. I'm here more of a pessimist. I claim, what is if he did? Really, was he did? I claim that we should accept this gap. There is no guarantee in your the authenticity of your inner experience is no guarantee that you will not do horrible things. What you are doing. Which is why I'm even tempted to say that, in contrast to my good friend Alain Badiou, I tend to agree with Plato, throw the poets out of the polis. Not quite, but you know, the sad result to which I came is, to give you a formula, no ethnic cleansing without poetry. Literally. Because again, it's the same paradox. I really, no, wait a minute. You will now, that now comes the tragedy. You will ask me, but what kind of poetry? It's too simple. You know what's the problem? Again, because for us, most of us, we are minimally decent. It's difficult to kill. You need a sacred myth, a sacred vision, a narrative. And there you need a religious figure, a poet, or whatever. And it's not only ex-Yugoslavia. Everybody laughs at Karadzic. All nations have their own Karadzic. They just remain poets, but they formulated the coordinates of their hatred, which can be very beautiful in poetic terms, or I even checked it in Rwanda, you remember, 10 years ago, when Hutus Tutsis. Of course, I immediately found him. There was a poet behind him. Hutu poet, central figure who for 15, 20 years was sowing the seed of hatred and so on and so on. No, I don't think that all poets are like that. I think there is a totally different type of poetry, but I'm deeply distrustful of poetry in this mythopoetic nation founding way. I think there are mega poets from Paul Celan to writers like Beckett and so on, who function in a totally different, in a totally different way. So, but nonetheless, let me go to my main line, because this was a short introduction. In this also orthodoxy, Chesterton tried to defend religion by providing a wonderful critical comment on how critics of religion criticize religion so much so that at the end they don't lose religion, but they lose their normal earthly life itself. Here is the quote. Men who begin to fight church for the sake of freedom and humanity, and by flinging away freedom and humanity, if only they may fight the church. I know a man who has such a passion for proving that he will have no personal existence after death, that he falls back on the position that he has no personal existence here and now. And so on and so on. Like, the secularists have not wrecked divine things, but the secularists have wrecked secular things, if that is any comfort to them, and so on and so on. And this idea is not totally wrong. Maybe I can give you as an example here, Marquis de Sade. He tries to assert brutally the earthly pleasures. The result is, if you are able to read, not because they are horrible, but because they are extremely boring, his most radical texts. I mean, what you lose is precisely earthly pleasure. You know, for example, his 120 Days of Sodom, no? After 600 examples of orgies, after somewhere number 150, it becomes pure mathematical set or logical set of permutations. Like 430, you take one cow, two women, one boy, a bull, they calculate it this way. The next one, two cows, one black guy, whatever he wants. Again, the paradox is that what you lose by fighting spirituality, otherworldly, you don't lose the other world. You lose this world in its fullness. I have a lot to say here, but we don't have time about this. But what I want to say is that the least we can say, and this is crucial, I think, is that today, the same should be said, unfortunately, also about some defenders of religion. They want to defend religion so much that they don't care if they lose the core of their religious experience itself just to destroy the opponent. For example, the liberal warriors on terror are so eager to fight the anti-democratic fundamentalism that they will end by flinging away freedom and democracy themselves if only they may fight terror. They have such a passion for proving that the non-Christian fundamentalism is the main threat to freedom that they are ready to fall back on the position that we have to limit our own freedom here and now and so on and so on. And now I come, of course, to what I have to say to the problematic part where I have problems with some of the acts of the state of Israel. I claim that the reason I'm critical is not in this sense of balance, you know, your Zionists are too fanatical, Arabs are too fanatical, or you should both make compromises or whatever. First, for example, considering anti-Semitism, there is for me absolutely no compromise. I've always rejected that idea, oh, but if some poor Arabs or blacks suffer really, and even if they put it in anti-Semitic terms, we should understand it. No, anti-Semitism is for me always unambiguously a sign that something is wrong in the very position politically, ethically you follow. For example, in the case of Chavez, Venezuela, he made a couple of, very limited, but nonetheless he did, remarks which could be read as potentially anti-Semitic, and I think it's a clear case one can locate it exactly of the crisis critical point of his, whatever you call it, Bolivarian revolution, where it became clear to him that he will not succeed in really building a new socialist economy, that he will have to make compromises with capitalism. So he is more and more, unfortunately, withdrawing into typical Latino American charismatic populism, which precisely is characterized by this logic of, as they put it in English, to have your cake and eat it, no? To have socialism, but to keep capitalism. To have it both ways, you absolutely need a figure like Peugeot. Because, you know, if you want to have capitalism which is not antagonistic, but because capitalism is antagonistic, somebody is to be blamed, if not the system, and so on, and so on. But what I'm saying is that, so what's my critical point here? One should first make things clear about anti-Semitism. First, I think, I wonder if you would agree that, the anti-Semitism that we know today really started in 11th, 12th century. I don't think there is a clear continuity from biblical times. I think that it all started with the rise of money economy. Also, because this is maybe the crucial shift in Christian tradition. For example, part of the same shift heaven, hell, purgatory. But yet, you know that Jacques Le Goff wrote a wonderful book, The Invention of Purgatory, where he, in a wonderful way, demonstrates how the idea of purgatory is unthinkable without money economy. The idea is, no, it's not simply this or that, you can pay, negotiate, and so on. So, second point I want to make is that the truly tragic reversal happened with the French Revolution, which till that point, that is to say, till the point when Jews were, at least in most European countries, given full civil citizens' rights, at least formally, did you notice a great change which occurred at that point? Up to that point, the problem, remember from Shakespeare and others, the problem is that of baptizing the Jews, of converting them. And so then the typical form of anti-Semitism is, did they really convert or do they secretly still practice their rituals and so on and so on? But exactly at the point when they were emancipated Jews, at least formally, legally, anti-Semitism radically changed. You get the 19th century anti-Semitism where nobody talks anymore about converting the Jews. The problem becomes, the anti-Semitism is much more naturalized. Because, you know, if you can convert the Jews, it means in a cynical way, but nonetheless, like, you give them a chance. What happens after the revolution is this idea of eternal Jews are demons, part of their faith. So paradoxically, this is crazy. It's exactly the emancipation of Jews in this French Revolution sense that opened up the space for the Holocaust. Then you have something very interesting at the end of the 19th century. You know that in the early 19th century, if you look at anti-Semitic moments in Fichte and some other philosophers, it's interesting how the logic totally changes. In Fichte, anti-Semitism is structured so that his reproach to the Jews is their particularism. Like, we are now all citizens, but you Jews don't want fully to be citizens. You keep to your secret rituals, specific way of life, and so on. But although it's generally the same formula, but the accent totally shifts in the late 19th century imperialist anti-Semitism or strong nation state. There, as you probably know, it's the opposite. It's Jews are not too particular, but too universal. It's we are patriots, Jews may be formally one of us, but in reality they freely float and so on and so on. Today I think that maybe the situation is getting confused again. Although it's interesting how in a polemic with Bernard André Lévy, and I'm really unfortunately opposed to him here, he claimed they are all the same, Ahmadinejad and the Nazis. I claim, okay, I don't know what happens in the depth of the depth, and incidentally, I have no sympathies for Ahmadinejad, my God. I supported publicly Mousavi. The result is that two of my crusaders in Iran are in prison now. I don't know what's happening with them, so I was pro-Mousavi. But, okay, let me read it. You know, for the Nazis, the problem was the wandering Jew. Hitler, at least till 41, you know, he even played with this crazy game, Palestina, Madagascar. He wanted to localize the Jews. For him, it was this invisible Jew, you know, he is nowhere invisible, but as such, he is everywhere. This is why Nazis played this stupid game of measuring noses and so on. The problem was how to pin down the Jew, no? With Ahmadinejad, it's the opposite. What bothers him is a Jew who is localized in a territory. He doesn't have a problem with, and he is, of course, hypocritical at this level, but he even does it. My friends from Iran send me, they are not friends of Ahmadinejad, photos how every year in some stupid holidays, Ahmadinejad receives representatives of the Jewish community, embraces them in public, and so on. It's totally different logic. I think that if we want to, this doesn't mean absolutely not that I in any way sympathize with Ahmadinejad. What I'm saying is that in judging dangerous, racist, whatever totalitarian phenomena, my God, we have to be careful in the sense of we miss the point if we bring things together too quickly into one basket. Let me give you my big example, for which I'm usually accused of this time for some people, even worse than anti-Semitism, Stalinist fantasies. Let's be serious. All I'm saying is that the logic that this, all these parallels, you know, the same as Stalinism destroys class enemy, anti-Semitism destroys Jews. No, the logic is totally different. I can give you some spontaneous elements which point towards the difference. For example, you know that the most mystical thing, enigmatic in Stalinism, is this ritual of public confessions. You know, like this mysterious ability even of the lowest trash, traitor, Trotskyist, whatever, to publicly tell the truth about himself. You know, this horrible confession, already as a young man, I hated the working class, I became British agent, here, there, whatever. Like, you are cheat, scum, but you know what you are. This is why you have to confess to a plot. In Nazism, this is totally meaningless. Do you know of any big public trials, although they could have organized there? The Nazis were, they had some Jewish leaders publicly confessing Jewish plot. It has no place in the Nazi universe. Not because it's better, but I claim maybe because it's worse. You know why? Because now I will say something very weird, but I know they were working through torture and so on. But the idea of confession at least allows a minimal formal way to treating you as a human being who is responsible, agent, confesses you. With Nazis and the Jew, there is no place for them. I don't have to prove to you that you did anything. All I have to prove to you is that you are a Jew, and that's it. The logic is totally different, which is why you have something in Stalinism, I had to laugh at. You know that even in the darkest hours of Gulag, once a year on Stalin's birthday, all the prisoners were gathered there, and they had all to sign a telegram to Stalin, wishing him all the best and success, blah, blah, blah. Sorry, but you see the point. You cannot even imagine this, like gathering all Jews in Auschwitz and signing telegrams. It functions in a different way. And I claim these are not minor differences. The whole logic is different. In a perverse way, this terrible institution of forced confessions and so on, means that in Stalinism you still get some legacy of enlightenment. The idea is even if even the lower Trotskyite traitor has access to universal reason from which he can see the objective truth. You don't find this there. Okay, so let me go further a little bit. Where I sincerely, without any hypocrisy, worry about things here is, you know what gave me the idea about my critical points? Maybe some of you know them, but nonetheless, I want to repeat them to you face to face. You know that in the United States, all of a sudden, when was it? Correct me if I'm wrong. I would say 20 years ago. This Bible fundamentalists, Baptist, whatever, all of a sudden started to fully support Zionism, the state of Israel. Now this worries me, because I'm sorry to tell you, but if there is a political-religious movement, which is, how should I put it, in its very nature anti-Semitic, my God, it's not a question even of, I will be cynical now, social choice. It's in their nature to be anti-Semitic. What game are they playing there? And I warned my American friends. For example, Fox News, always pro-Zionist. You know who was their most popular commentator? That total lunatic Glenn Beck. You read, they had to fire him, I think about 2 months ago or when, no? Because he went ballistic and became openly anti-Semitic. So I claim that no matter how they strategically support you now, this is dangerous for your own identity. Why? Now let me put this critical point. When I did use the expression, and let me explain, when I spoke about Zionist anti-Semitism, it's not meant as kind of a cheap dialectical paradox. It's as simple as that. In the United States, I often participated in political debates. And then I noticed how Zionist Jews attacked Jews who were even a little bit critical towards the politics of state of Israel. And the attack was like this. You pretend to be one of us, but you are not really organically one of us. You are a free-floating cosmopolitan. I will not go too far, but you got the point. It's exactly the same way in which in the late 19th century, nation states castigated the Jews. Now, this is the tragic predicament, because if anything, the absolute greatness of you Jews was that you stood in, precisely because you were excluded from direct participation in state power, you stood for what I call the public use of reason. You embodied that. And it's very sad if you will get caught in this. I'm not saying Zionism is a crime in this United Nations non-aligned way. I think it's way too simplistic. All I am saying is that if you adopt this logic, then you got into problems. What kind of problems? In one of my book, I hope so that I don't repeat myself too much. I used it, I hope you don't know it, so I can repeat it. I think this idea is perfect to show you what is wrong with this right-wing support and why you shouldn't fall into this trap. In July 2008, the Austrian daily, left-center daily, Die Presse, published a wonderful caricature showing two neo-Nazi right-wingers ironically turning around. You know this well-known Zionist argument: if you criticize the politics of Israel on the West Bank, the mantra is, yes, of course, we have nothing against it, state of Israel should be criticized, but it shouldn't be misused for anti-Semitic purposes. But of course, then the problem is that whatever you say, they will say it is anti-Semitic. Okay, if this is not wonderful, I mean, the caricature shows this two neo-Nazi guy, and one holds in his hand a newspaper criticizing the state of Israel and tells to the other, you see how disgusting this is. A totally legitimate anti-Semitism is brutally misused for an unfair critique of the state of Israel. This is the truth, I warn you. Why? Because you know what is the danger here? Here I again deeply disagree. I think it's dangerous, effectively, what he's saying. Dangerous, my God, for the Jewish identity. Bernard Henri Lévy, and I do talk with him, I have twice debates with him, but nonetheless, who proposed in his book, probably it is translated here, I'm not sure, The Left in Dark Times, his formula is, to cut it short, and I literally quote him, the anti-Semitism of the 21st century will be progressive leftist or there will be none. And he goes, I provoke him in the talk, so far as to claim that anti-capitalism is today a code for anti-Semitism. You know, the irony, the standard Marxist doxa is that anti-Semitism is a fake code for anti-capitalism. You want to be anti-capitalist, you don't have courage to be, you focus it on the wrong guy. He claims the opposite. And putting all this accent into anti-Semitism in today's European left. Did you notice a couple of things? The first thing is how the same guys who worry so much about leftist anti-Semitism, there are elements of it, I admit it. But they are in today's Western Europe. Nothing, this is bad news for you and for me, nothing compared to, they call some people here new anti-Semitism, compared to the good old European right-wing anti-Semitism. The bad news is that it's back kicking, driving, heavy, very big. It's horrible. In all this post-communist East European countries, Hungary, Romania, Poland. It's not even totally...
The city wants to shut us down.
The city?
Yes, speakers. They don't allow the speakers outside.
Really?
So we can...
Okay, I will, no, I'm so sad. Okay, but what I wanted to tell you is that, don't focus on the wrong enemies. I'm not saying to you, you are guilty of everything, embrace Arabs, everything will be okay. All I'm saying is that instead of being afraid of the events in Egypt, focus on the real dangers this new populist right-wing, directly anti-Semitic explosion all around in Western Europe, which is the good old-fashioned right-wing explosion. Don't focus on those couple of leftists, whatever, who may be confused. You know what is coming out of Europe now? Look, in Istanbul, there was a gay parade with thousands of people, no incidents. Did you read in your newspapers what happened in Belgrade, in Zagreb, and so on? There were not only counter demonstrations, but brutal physical attacks, and so on. People died, my God. Or, I will conclude very, sorry, okay.
That I don't speak close enough. I have this fellatio problem.
What is the problem?
יש לנו בעיה, השכנים התלוננו, אנחנו חייבים לסגור את הרמקולים בחוץ.
So what does it mean? Should I shout more?
People outside, yes.
אז תסגרו את הרמקולים ותנו לו להמשיך לדבר, נו?
There are dangers, but listen, my friend Slovene journalist was there all the time. He was provoking all the time the people there. Do you think the Jews are against Mubarak and so on? From all of them he got the same answer. No, this is us about our freedom. Jews have nothing to do with this. You remember one tank was painted with Star of David. They even explained to me then, it's not all Jews are behind the army. No, they said it is, you paint us Jews as the enemy, but no, this is the real Jew in the sense of the enemy, not the Jews. I think one in the crowd. In New York they discovered a box and I kept this box.
No.
You are much more open here in spite of all than New York, you know this. In the sense that, for example, I was not a great friend, but I spoke with Edward Schneider. He told me he felt here free compared to New York. Here in Tel Aviv, not on the west. But I spoke only 1 hour and a half.
I just suggest like that we'll fix it inside, we'll move for Q&A a little bit, and after it, Slavoj will sign books out there. Where do you sign the books? Out there. Okay, and after, so we'll do a small session.
I'm sorry, but you know, let me tell you what I really want to say. I feel sad because I feel like coitus interruptus, because the crucial part, which at least through which I regained a little bit of my theoretical dignity, not just joke, I had to. You know what I propose?
Okay, 1 second.
Yes, I propose this. Do you have here an email address?
Yes.
Do you have an email address here? Yes. That I email to you the complete text, anyone to come here. I did want to include some dirty jokes, of course. One, okay. Two, of how idiot. Didn't you see the film, working class film, Brush Off? It's the British with Ivan McGregor when he was young, before he became Jedi and all that. You know what? It's a movie where a girl and boy are flirting. And she, when they reach her home after a date, she tells him, why don't you come up to my place for a coffee? And he says, oh, but it's a problem, I don't drink coffee. She says, no problem, I don't have any. Now this double negation is the absolute erotic invitation. And then I wanted to develop this through a wonderful line from Ninochka, Ernst Lubitsch. You know, when a guy enters a cafeteria and says, can I have coffee without cream? And the waiter answers, sorry, we run out of cream, we only have milk, so can I give you coffee without milk? I mean, if you understand this, you understand Hegel. What does it mean, determinate negation and so on, no? So I want to focus on how ideology functions against this background. You will get the text, okay?
Yeah. I would suggest that we will take 3-4 questions.
As a good Stalin, did you distribute them, organize them? No.
It's all, yeah, definitely. As you wrote them. So the reason that if we do one question, one answer, the answer will take 1 hour. So I would suggest to take 4 questions, also from people from outside.
So who will collect the 5 questions?
They will ask it.
Oh, because I know this is how it goes.
Because you're going to get email, you should buy the books.
Because he's secretly Jungian. No. I discovered. Yes, all Jung can go. And Jung had this bullshit, 3-4 masculine feminine.
So, what I suggest, we'll take 4 questions, then Slavoj will answer, and then when he'll sign books outside, probably you can continue speak with him, and probably in a certain time the police will come to arrest him, and that will be the end of the event.
They're on their way.
And also, what I said, people asked me when I said if somebody wants to contribute to the Freedom Theater, how to do it. So Matan is here, so Matan can collect the phone numbers or emails of people who want to help the Freedom Theater. And I suggest that where we do the signing, people can give their email that maybe Tolad can send them after the text.
Why is it that you always make me anti-Semitic? Like, whenever you organize something, at the end, it turns into money. I really think that some anti-Semites are hiring him to embody all the anti-Semitic clichés, so that if you start to like Jews, you know.
It's even better. All the money he received back for his flight ticket and Oren Aaron in Ramallah, I took all the money and I sent it direct to the Freedom Theater.
So you say, but then you spend 1,000 shekels per night for dinner. Right?
Absolutely. Okay, so I would collect 6-7 questions.
yes, there. Just be loud, please. I'm sorry.
Loud and short.
Yeah. I see. Okay.
Do you think there should be any limitations on free speech other than a libel or something? And whose right is it to enforce it?
Yeah.
That's easy. I think yes, and he has the right to enforce it.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think there's too much freedom.
One second there.
Can I ask about, more in a critical way, what about the security judge and...
We can't hear you.
A little bit louder, please.
Do you
think he shatters the Torahs of the Khan? The center and the outside, like his snowball lecture, like ideology destroys the major subjectivity.
Okay, last question. I can't use there.
Is there any chance for reforming the system or
what?
Is there any chance for reforming of the system or of the capital? You were talking about the criticism of.
Yeah.
Capitalism, or do we have to go more radical than that?
Yeah. Okay, the last one, I saw a hand coming out there and I didn't see the person, so I thought I should give a hand a chance to speak.
You said you're here in accordance with Pakbi's call, but...
No, he said that.
I said
okay. Woody said it, but you haven't mentioned Pakbi or the BDS or any criticism of Israel, all serious real lecture, and I wanted to know why have you been avoiding that? And why have you been saying that Zionism isn't a crime, and without criticizing Zionism in any way?
No, but okay.
fucking did that shit stuff. One, two, three, four, five, six.
I think it's enough.
Okay. First, I would like... I would like to begin at the end. Please, the answer is vulgar and very clear. Sorry? I'm sorry. The question was, why, although I'm here on that BDS sadomaso, I said, why didn't I explicitly support it or say more about it, criticizing Zionism? On the contrary, I was even claiming Zionism is not a crime, and so on and so on. My God, listen, I've written, believe me, enough critical things that just type into, how is that bullshit called? Type the New Republic or whatever, where I'm accused quite seriously of advocating the position that all Jews, that we need a repeated Holocaust, that all Jews should be killed, except those who are publicly critical of the state of Israel. And it's incredible how I cannot get rid of this. You know what's the origin? In one of my books, I say this, but how? Unambiguously. I resume the line of argumentation of, he was here, maybe you know it, of Jean-Claude Milner in his criminal, Les tendances criminelles de l'Europe, criminal tendencies of democratic Europe, where he claims today's European Union is the continuation of Hitler with other means. Unified Europe means the intruder Jews must be annihilated, and so on. So all I do is it's absolutely, how should I emphasize it more, unambiguous. And the result is now this sticks to me. And when I just say, but listen, this is the line of the enemy, they claim, yeah, he tries to squeeze his way out, and so on, and so on. So, but okay, to answer your questions, yes, no, all I'm saying is that today I am not sure, I don't know enough. From what I know, I'm not ready to do it 100%, to fully identify what Zionism meant historically, 100 years ago, and so on, with today's politics of the state of Israel. I'm not defending anything. Sometimes I even, crime of the crimes, quote half positively Ben Gurion. But you know why? No, let me be clear. Not that I agree with him, but what I find fascinating is that first generation, 50s leaders, or Moshe Dayan, is that I disagree with them everything, but it's so refreshing that they at least say openly what is to be said and don't cheat their bullshit on us. They're openly saying, let it be clear, we have no right to be here. It's all a question of power. We are taking their land. And he says this, Ben Gurion. He says, I have in my violence book, I think, I have quotes from Ben Gurion, from Dayan. You know, this is, for me, not more militaristic. This is the beginning of normal talk. The most horrible thing is when you have this purely beatific position, like the one I read yesterday in, because I always like to read right wing. Udi told me, read Haaretz. I said, fuck you, I read Jerusalem Post. And it was in the United States, I watch only Fox News and so on. And it was like a big article, we Jews didn't steal any land, everything was legally bought. We were just like, again, the beginning is this admission that you don't have simply full right or whatever here. This is why I know what he's doing, don't misunderstand me. I'm mega critical of Ehud Barak and so on. But for that brief moment, even if it was demagogy, I don't care. When he said, you remember some 10 years ago, when he was asked, what would he have done if he were to be a young Palestinian? He said, clear, I would have joined the terrorist group. You know, this means, like, the worst thing today is that on behalf of this war on terror, we are so much demonizing the enemy and so on and so on. that even this, I don't care about did he mean it sincerely or not. But so to let you know about BDS, I fully support it. But why? Because it is done by you here, Jews and Palestinians. Where I have, but I'm not sure it's even disagreement with Udi, if you want to expand it to Europe, you should be very careful, because yeah, you don't. Okay, I stop. Okay, it's better that I don't go.
No, don't stop.
All I'm saying is that it's it is clear that I know what you will tell me, that no real right winger talks about BDS and so on. No, and I agree that they that even the anti-Semitic right, they function in a totally different way, and so on and so on. No, no. So again, I don't have, my God, any problem being critical here. As to the solution, I don't know. I don't have a solution. On the one hand, to the horror of some of my radical leftist friends, I conditionally, in a very limited way, and I had problems with this in Ramallah.
I just want to make clear here, BDS is not a Stalinistic movement that you have to say exactly what you want to hear. BDS is boycott, divestment, and sanction against Israel. It's a movement that decide to follow that the only way to have a true dialogue with Palestine. One second, I'm answering.
אתה קטעת אותו והוא היה באמצע לענות. עכשיו אתה יורד עליה, זה לא בסדר, שאלה שלה יפה, ואתה אומר לה שהיא סטליניסטית, זה ממש לא לעניין. התשובה שלך.
מה?
זה עדיין לא לעניין. ממש לא לעניין. לא יפה.
With all the respect, we are working together with solidarity. We're doing stuff that it's not only talking, but we have in speech act and act speech. What we do is also a political act that we are working in solidarity together. The issue of the BDS was very important, that even Slavoj might not agree with something, and it's totally open conversation and legitimate one. The idea is that we let the Palestinians, we decided that we let the Palestinians to lead the resistance against the occupation, and once they open a whole campaign that opened a non-violent space for a dialogue, we decided that also people who are not sure they agree with academic and cultural boycott, we really respect that they decide to follow it in solidarity with the Palestinian people. So we spoke with Pavgi and people in Ramallah, and we explained the situation, and they thought that it's really great, because boycott, divestment, and sanction, it's not against individual in Israel, it's against the movement of every institutional one. And if we follow what the BDS do, I didn't understand why she attacking, why he's not giving a whole lecture on BDS. Because that's not his job.
He can
think that Zionism is not a crime and yet support the BDS. Because people can read Zionism in different way. People can go to Martin Buber. People can choose any other way they want to deal with it. We might agree or disagree, but it has no connection to BDS. Some people can claim that Zionism has an option to become a non-racist place, and it's a legitimate call inside the discourse. Has no connection that we are in solidarity with the Palestinian in their fight against occupation, in the right of return and equality for all Palestinians everywhere between the Jordan River and the sea.
Let me put it in another way, very honestly. Why I moderate it, why I support it, I'm not playing any dirty games here. Look, what I agree with, I'm not an idiot. I'm not saying you are demonic, the symbol of oppression today, and all you can do is to whip yourself and invite every Arab to move here to be tasteless or whatever. What I'm saying is this. After you cut all the crap, sorry, but you are, not you, I'm sorry, the state of Israel, is slowly strangling the West Bank. My God, look at the map. That's the first thing to do. I think everywhere there should be a map of how the West Bank really looks, who has what there, where, and so on. And then, you know what is happening, what is the source of this? Haaretz, New York Times, not Al-Qaeda, Bin Laden, or whatever. Listen, you know, there are things happening there, like burning of olive groves, poisoning of wells. It's a constant pressure. You are doing fucking some kind of gradual colonization there. And it's clear why you are, not you, sorry, the state of Israel is doing it the way it is doing it. Because it cannot do it in one big move, because then you don't know, you have to decide what to do with Palestinians. This is a very reasonable strategy to drag on. My God, Tzipi Livni attacked along these lines, maybe, not quite along these lines, but you know, so if I cannot, so again, I'm not saying that you are the worst case today. I know, I'm the first one to say, you are not neo-Nazis or what, there are terrible, more horrible things going around in the world, and it makes me horrible, like, now I will be provocative. Look at Democratic Republic of Congo, with horrors there. Every Congolese would probably sell his mother into slavery if he or she were to be able to move to the West Bank, probably, no? I'm not saying this. This is for me even, it's a local conflict. But I am saying, my God, I don't see anything racist or whatever to put in a totally non-violent way a little bit of non-violent pressure on the state. That's all I'm saying. And I totally agree when you say, why not others? Okay, let's expand it, my God. I think that here, the West is, I agree, the West is disgusting. It's not only China. China even, I'm starting to suspect, is not as bad as it, you know, why focus so much on China? When I was in India, I was shocked what is going on there. India enjoys this privilege of, you know, India, the greatest, the largest living democracy. It's a nightmare. Did you see the shitty movie Slumdog Millionaire? You remember at the beginning when the guy, a small crook, is tortured at the police station? I asked my friends there, listen, is this common practice? They told me, absolutely common practice. Everyone is tortured if you are not a rich guy with connections. They even told me that among the intellectuals in India, there is an ironic appeal to Indian police, please treat us at least like the Chinese police in Tibet treats Tibetans. That is to say, the idea is that there at least you are tortured only if you are suspected with Dalai Lama links or whatever. In India, everyone is tortured. So yes, I agree, I don't think that Zionism a synonym of racism today or whatever and so on and so on. What I fear, let me give you a pessimist judgment, but you see, I want you to avoid these terrible mistakes, but here I will use the term mistake in this cynical Talleyrand sense, you know, when Talleyrand said, this is not a crime, this is much worse, this is a mistake, you know. For example, you remember immediately, when reacting to Tahrir Square, one of your guys said, oh, we have to admit it, some nations are not mature for democracy. On the contrary, things like Tahrir Square are the only chance for, in the long term, with all the problems this may bring in short term, in long term, for anti-Semitism to disappear, at least mostly from Arab countries. My God, this is the first popular movement where there is no anti-Semitism there. And the madness, my God, of not solidarizing yourself with it, but on showing sympathy with it. The only one who played in this rebellion anti-Semitic card was Mubarak. I saw on CNN a report when Tahrir Square was, whatever it was, they went to the countryside. Did a very good move and inquired, like, what's going on there? And the line of Mubarak agent, official there, is, you know, keep out of it, Tahrir Square is a Zionist plot, and so on. Sorry, that was the only guy who played. I know it is difficult. I'm not proposing easy solutions, and so on. But what I insist in this, with all undoubted anti-Semitic elements, and so on, and so on, the hatred of this old-fashioned European right-wing anti-Semitism is much more dangerous, much more historically substantial, and so on and so on. So again, my God, are you aware what you are playing? Well, my nightmare is this situation. We all know what the West is now doing, a very dirty game. You remember when you read about those, there is a conflict between Copts and Muslims? My friends who know what's going on there are telling me these are all Mubarak forces still plotting. Because remember what happened in Egypt. People won. Fuck it. In what sense? The whole state apparatus, army is the same it was before. And the true battle is going on now. This solidarity is cheap. We are millions there. We cry. Oh, what a wonderful moment. I don't care about that. The problem is the day after. How you translate. And what I fear is that since, of course, the result of this tumult is much worse economic situation, that all this, if democracy will be left to disappear, any genuine democracy, then you will have a new authoritarian regime. Then you fear anti-Semitism, not of this democracy there, my God, and so on. You should be glad. Again, the first massive Arab movement without any traces of anti-Semitism. And here it was, let me conclude with a joke, here it was the hypocrisy of the West. You know, yesterday already I mentioned, I'm sorry if I repeat myself, but I like obscenities. Did you see Trifo, the movie Day for Night, American Night, that about movie making? You know when a guy wants to screw a girl all the time, telling her, oh, let's do it, finally they're alone by a lake because their car breaks down, and she tells her, oh, my love, let's do it now, I want it so much, I'm trying for months, look, we have a chance, for half an hour we are alone, her, and you know what she does? She said, okay, why not, and starts to unbutton her trousers, and of course, she's talking, how do you mean, just like that, you know, like, this is how the West is doing with Egypt. All the time the Western liberals were saying, oh, the Arabs can be mobilized only on anti-Semitic, religious fundamentalist, populist, whatever level, nationalist. Now we got a democratic uprising, and we are like that guy, oh my God, you mean just like this? Don't miss this chance, it's a unique chance. It's a unique chance. Now I will give you an answer, which again, maybe you will accuse me of kissing. You are on the line. You will accuse me of kissing your ass, but you know, my problem with Levinas is no wonder he is so popular among the Christians in the West. I think he is secretly Christianizing Judaism. What I found so great in Jewish ethical tradition is collective sense. Fuck it, no, the original ethical experience is not me and your stupid face. Third is here from the very beginning. The original ethical experience is we are in love, fascinated with each other. But then you look around. Who is there whom I have to ignore to be with you? Like, for me, I don't believe this, that the zero level is the other's face and so on. So again, he here loses a certain collective, for him, collective. Then he says, original ethical experience is this call of the other's face. Then he says, with the third one comes strategy, who is enemy bread. No, the third one, collective, is fundamentally ethical. When there was then this, ideology, intersubjectivity, this is a tricky question for theoretical reasons. I don't have now the time to go into them. I don't share this Habermasian idea that the reference to fight ideology can be intersubjectivity. To make even a step further, I think that this is based on a wrong liberal reading of Hegel, which was started by Habermas, which is now popularized in the United States by all those Pittsburgh Hegelians. Hegel focused on recognition, you know, as if the secret emancipatory motive of Hegel is recognition. But to answer this seriously, again, I would have to go in detail. Free speech and so on and so on. I'm here. I don't have any problems to say, yes, there should be certain limitations. For example, fuck it with anti-Semitism and so on. I'm not ready to say, let's leave it open and people will see the truth. Fuck it, people may not see the truth. Now you will say, but who will do it? Well, we have to fight for who will do it. But I don't believe in this liberal dream like Chomsky did in defending that for his own, you know. Just, I think this is, I am not afraid of this, because I think that there are already ideological constraints in how we work. It's not that, I think this is a false approach that, you know, we have a free space and then the state will intervene. Fuck it, this space is not free. This reform or whatever. No? Now it's easy. First, I don't believe in this old duality reform revolution. I'm for the revolution, but not for this old-fashioned, you know, barricades and so on. For example, Tahrir Square I like, because all the violence was from the opposite side. They just went public, occupied a certain space. All the violence were those, you remember, I had to laugh, those Mubarak idiots on camels all of a sudden, and then they said, oh, the other part of the people should also speak or the ridiculous things and so on.
But the American reporters.
Sorry?
But there was the American reporters, that wasn't violence.
You mean because there was American reporter or what?
No, because he was right.
Listen, whatever you want to prove by this, of course things, if you look at them closely, are always more suspect. The good, let's go to the extreme with this rape. Dominique Strauss-Kahn. I know that what he was doing in IMF, that he more and more was opposed to the American line in banking, you know. So he was doing good. Okay, I am not saying it was all a plot against him, because I don't know. And just saying things are not so simple here. But you know, again, if you look at this concrete way, but there was also this rape and so on, you know, then you can complicate everything, you know, like, but the Allies were also bombing Dresden and so on. Yes, they were, and we should condemn it. But this changes in nothing the fact that the Allies were right and Hitler was the bad guy. I think we shouldn't dare to confess things in this sense. But an important thing to conclude, the last answer, this reform and so on. You know? Sorry? Yeah, you're the last. Listen, don't be too pessimist here. People are telling us we are utopians, impossible and so on. But impossible things, miracles happen. Tahrir Square was a miracle. Miracles, of course, I'm not religious, in the sense of things that you cannot expect, believe that they will happen. Listen, my last line, maybe some of you know it. I'm sorry, but it's crucial. You know when people tell you something, it's impossible. Did you notice how strange the couple possible-impossible functions today? On the one hand, in the spheres of private pleasures and technology, we are being told everything is possible. Like, oh, we will fly to the moon, we will genetically grow our organs, become immortal, even in New York. I couldn't resist. You may have suspected that there will be a dirty aspect. I met in New York a surgeon who can, for $15,000 for the last price, cut your penis into two, so you can do it with, say, 2 minutes. So all this is possible. But this is paradoxical. They promise you to become immortal, to fly to moon, to have 2 penises, then go. To raise healthcare or social welfare for 1%, oh, that's impossible. We become non-competitive and so on. No? So, you know, we come to this old story in the West that, to quote my old friend Frederick Jensen, that, while it is easy for us to imagine today the end of all life on Earth, comet, asteroid, then the end of capitalism, or even modest, we may all be dead, but capitalism is here. So to conclude with a good thing about the Chinese, I read somewhere, maybe you also did, that a month or so ago, the Chinese government, I don't know which ministry, adopted a wonderful measure. Not kidding, I checked it out with my friends. The measure is to prohibit in all public media, comics, books, TV, movies, all stories which contain time travel and alternate realities. Claiming that history is serious, we cannot do such superficial games with this. Of course, they are afraid that people will even imagine a different society. But what you know, what is so sad is that the Chinese at least still need the prohibition, you know. With us, we don't need the prohibition, we just accept it. In economy, sorry, we cannot raise the expenses for 1%, it would be counterproductive or whatever. This is our duty. We will not provide easy answers, practical intellectuals. But we can open the space and, you know, like, change a little bit this weird relationship between possibility and impossibility. maybe we will not all of us be, sorry for vulgarity, screwing two women at the same time or become immortal, but maybe we can have a little bit more of social security or whatever and so on. I wanted to see the question. Whenever somebody is praising me, the knife is getting there.
That the takeoff is the right thing in this situation, that we've taken the territory, I agree with you.
But
it's not a takeoff.
It's not
the government of this country. That is new democracy. And we want to agree that this is the point that we need to decide. The government of Israel is making all these objectives. Like everyone that here that I don't know them, but I suppose that...
Okay, no, I don't have a problem.
And this is the first point. To make the clarification, the state and will be part of the people, and the reality is of a digital democracy that we have now.
Thank you. It's a democracy for Jews only, and that's why, because it's democracy, we boycott it, because we chose this government who do these crimes.
I don't know
if they are not democracy. Why do they take TikTok? Because that's why I agree with you, not with you. That's why I stopped
you. One time, 4 years, we are thinking about
terms. Only Jews. Jews only. Okay. We really prefer no democracy than democracy only for one race. And what you want to do is...
No, it's your own.
I understand that.